gentlemen, please join me in welcoming your mayor and deputy mayor, Mayor Rick Kriseman and Deputy Mayor Kanika Tomlin!
Good afternoon, everyone. This is impressive. Wow. Welcome. We want to thank all of you for being here today, and this is kind of historic what we're doing here, something that I don't think has ever been done in our history. So we're thrilled to have all of you here, and more importantly, we're thrilled to have all of you as employees of this great city.
Absolutely.
We can't get anything done without you guys. You all are the ones who make everything happen on a day-to-day basis, so I want to say thank you. You know, we're coming up on 100 days now, and the first 100 days was kind of spent hearing from the community and meeting members of the community. But I want to spend the next 100 days trying to get out and meet with each one of you. So you will see the deputy mayor and I coming to your departments and hopefully having a chance to meet each of you individually so that we can say hello and personally say thank you to each of you. So this is an exciting time. We have with us today, I want to recognize our great city council. If you'll give them a great hand. Woo! Our chair of city council, Bill Coach Dudley, he'll be speaking to you in a little bit. Charlie Gertis, Jim Kennedy, I see Carl Nurse, Darden Rice, Amy Foster, and our Vice Chair, Steve Cornell. We couldn't do anything that we do in the city without the partnership and the teamwork of this great city council. So I want to say thank you to you guys.
Absolutely. Thank you guys.
And in the front row, and you'll hear from him a little bit later today, is a guy who stepped up for this city and for my administration in a big way. And I want to say thank you publicly to Dr. Gary Cornwell, our city administrator. We have an administration that is really committed to taking this city to that next level, and a major part of this team is my incredibly talented deputy mayor, Dr. Kanika Tomlin, who's going to talk to us a little bit about the vision for this great city. Dr. Tomlin.
Thank you, Mayor. Thank you, Mayor, for the opportunity to do this fantastic job, and thank you to each of you for being here today. Pardon me because I'm catching my breath, not from running up the aisle, but literally seeing this team gathered together this way takes my breath away. This is momentous. This is fantastic, and we are so glad that you're here with us. This is one of the most important experiences we will have as a team during our time of shared service to the city. Today, we introduce our vision. It's an overarching goal that guides all of our actions every day. We're going to introduce it to you so that you can understand it and buy into it right away, because we know the only way that we'll get there, the only way we'll reach that destination, is with the help of each and every one of you. Individually, the work you do is fantastic. It's amazing. You make a significant difference in the lives of the 250,000 people who live here, and it goes without saying just how much that difference sets the tone for our city. Departmentally, you're doing wonderful things. The mayor and I have been both impressed and thoroughly grateful for the great team that we inherit and the great plans that each of your departments carry out in your work every day. But the one area that we saw for improvement, the one piece that felt to be missing, was a common goal. That regardless of what we come to do every day, the why we come to do it, we wanted to define. So each of us have our different paths, but we share a common call to action to serve this great city of St. Petersburg. We wanted to put that to words, create strategic pathways that guide how we will get there, and delineate the values of who we are and who we aspire to be. So we're going to show you a video that covers that and talks a little bit about the vision, why it matters, and what you can do to help us achieve it. But before we show that video, I wanted to tell you just a little bit about how we got to this place. One of the most significant benefits of the mayor's successful campaign is that he had an opportunity to interact with people from every corner of this community. He had a chance to talk to them about their hopes and their fears, their needs and their desires, and what it is that they see for this great city of St. Petersburg. He brought all of that feedback back as data, and we used that feedback to help us build this vision. So you'll see that reflected in the vision. You'll see feedback from the team here. We talked to people who've been here for 50 years, Jet Jackson. We've talked to people who've been here for 5 days. We talked to people throughout the team to understand where it is we need to go as a city. We also talked to people, other opinion leaders, looked at what best practices are in other cities, and the result of what you'll see is the vision that we reveal today, and we thank you in advance for everything that you'll do to help us achieve it. So with that, let's go ahead and check out what it means for the sun to shine here in St. Petersburg.
St. Petersburg will be a city of opportunity, where the sun shines on all who come to live, work, and play. We will be an innovative, creative, and competitive community that honors our past while pursuing our future.
St. Petersburg will be a city of opportunity.
Where the sun shines.
Where the sun shines.
Where the sun shines.
On all who come to live, work, and play.
We will be an innovative,
creative,
and competitive community
that honors our past
while pursuing our future.
It's a new day in the Sunshine City. A new administration with new energy, riding a wave of hope and optimism. Today we know we can be a daring city, a beacon of progress. The city of St. Petersburg will realize our vision through 4 strategic pathways: stewardship and fiscal responsibility, innovation, impactful service, and community engagement. These pathways arise from our collective values. We value accountable servant leadership that puts people and their well-being first. We value empowerment that fosters ownership and the realization of every opportunity's potential. We value transparent access to the information that informs decisions. We celebrate diversity and respect for the value that it brings. We value inclusive practices that promote equality and justice. And we value responsive processes that produce sustainable outcomes that build a seamless city. Together, we will seek that mighty thread that will knit all that we are and all that we do into a united whole. A 21st century city whose fabled sunshine brightens all points of our compass, north, south, east, and west. If we do that, we will have honored our history and embraced our future. The sun shines here.
The sun shines here in St. Pete.
The sun shines here in St. Petersburg because the arts are delicious.
Because young adults have a real opportunity to make a difference.
The sun is always shining on Central Avenue.
The sun shines here in South St. Pete.
The sun shines here on the Deuces Live.
The sun shines here because Beach Drive is vibrant.
Because the people are awesome.
We will work together, the city's team, residents, businesses, and community leaders, to transform our vision into reality. The city is already hard at work matching our resources and policies to our priorities. But that's only the beginning. Every year, our team here at the city will work with our partners, civic groups, neighborhood associations, our school system, and you to strategize about how we can align our efforts along these pathways in a way that delivers us to our goal. Each year, we will build on the progress made during the year before. Each year, we will become a stronger, more innovative, creative, and competitive city. And each year, we will build on our many points of pride about how and why the sun shines here.
Thank you for all you do for this great city, our home.
Without you, this vision and these values are just words on a page. We need you to work with us to make this a truly shared vision.
St. Petersburg is a city on the cusp. The future is bright. Let's get there together.
The sun shines here. As you can see, the sun is definitely shining on St. Petersburg. We wanted to take a quick minute to recognize some of our city stars of that video. Agnieszka Brooks and Codes, is Agnieszka here? Katie Brew and Parks and Rec. Jet Jackson and Parks and Rec, thank you, Jet. Paul and Keisha from our libraries. Chris Henderson from Fire and Rescue. And of course, Dr. Gary Cornwell. As the video explained, the sun shines here is the way we are going to articulate what it means to live in St. Petersburg and what it means to fill every opportunity's potential. But as it relates to the city team, we know that that begins and ends with you. So today is the start of a journey that we will take together. In addition to hearing the mayor talk about this vision all the time, you will also hear your leaders speak about it. We'll be talking about it in the community, and it will grow to be words from being words on a page to being actual practices and policies that we live every day.
Thank you, Deputy Mayor. The sun does shine here on all of us in this great city, but as I said at the beginning, it starts with you all. You all are the fabric of this team. You are the ones that make this city work on a daily basis. And this is a new day. What we're starting here today and doing this is representative of what we believe is a new day here in St. Petersburg, where we're going to do things differently. We want to do them better. We want to get over that cusp and become the greatest city, not only in the state of Florida, but in the entire country. And we know we can do that, but we can't do it without each and every one of you. So what we're going to ask of all of you is we want your help. We want to change the climate and the tone in this community and the whole culture in this community to be one of a can-do spirit, where no is no longer the first answer that we get, but it's the last answer we give, where we try and solve problems rather than saying we can't handle it and we can't do it. And we know that working together as a team, we can get there. It doesn't take one individual person. It takes everybody coming together as a team. And we have a great example of that right here in this great city with our baseball team. The Rays have been as successful as they've been on the field, not because they have individual stars, but because they've come together as a team that cares about each other, that looks out for one another, and looks out to do the best job they can together. And I'm very proud to have the opportunity to introduce the man who has created that atmosphere, who has brought them together as a team and brought the success to this community that we so deserve, and that is the Rays manager, Joe Maddon.
All right, if you catch this baseball, you win two free tickets for tonight's game. It's autographed by Joe Maddon. They're autographed. Two free tickets for tonight's game. Two free tickets. All right, if you caught one of those baseballs, just stay here right afterwards. We'll get your name. And Mr. Joe Maddon.
Good afternoon. Where's Anita? Hi, honey. That's Westy's wife back there. I promised him I would say something. Westy's our clubhouse everything right now. He's also the traveling secretary. Really pleased to have this opportunity to speak with you guys today and ladies. Something like this really always helps me in the job that I do too. And as the mayor talked about, I want to treat this as though it was a team meeting. I just had my first one. Didn't have a team meeting on opening day because I do not like to bother the players on the very first game of the season. I really want them just to come out and have kind of a normal day, and I try to stay out of their way. So yesterday I did have that meeting with them, and I want to include some of the thoughts today that I shared with them yesterday and treat this as though you guys are members of the race. And my voice is going to get crackly once in a while, so when I pause to do that, please excuse me. I'm almost a lot like Monsignor Mazzari back when I was a kid. I never wondered why. I always wondered why I was always clearing his voice. He must have eaten a lot of dark chocolate, too. Okay, so here we're going to go. In regarding, like, let's go back to 2006 and 2007. Came over from Anaheim. I was with the Angels, honestly, for 30 years. I know it's hard to believe. But I was there from 1976 to 2005 as a player and then as a minor league manager, a scout, coach, got to the big leagues in 94, did all kinds of different jobs out there. But the real part about this, what I'm going to talk about, was generated right around 1984, 1985, when I was put in charge of the instructional league and became the field coordinator for the entire organization. Okay, I'm working 1984. I'm out in the batting cages and throwing my BP. And Gene Mock was the manager for the people that have been around. If you remember, Gene was the most intimidating, best baseball man I've ever been around. But Gene walks up to me and told me, "You've created a great atmosphere around here." And I said, "Thank you." And I walked away and had no idea what he was talking about. Zero. I didn't. Because it's just, you're just doing your thing. You're just being yourself. You're doing what you think is right. So what that forced me to do was to stop and think, well, what am I doing? What are we doing here? What am I doing here specifically? So it caused me to sit back and try to evaluate what was going on here. What exactly were we doing? And this was my interpretation of what we were doing at that time. A, we were building relationships. Unless you build relationships, things just cannot work out, because what eventually flows out of relationships is our trust between people. If you guys don't trust each other, if we don't trust each other, I promise you, nothing works. Whether we trust each other in our families, trust each other where we work, if you don't have trust, I promise you, nothing works. It just can't work. So what I figured out in 1985 was we kind of got to know each other. We built these strong relationships. And from that, we really trusted one another to the point where, and here's the key to it, when we trust each other, at that point, we could have a real honest exchange of ideas. It could absolutely be free and clear without me worrying about hurting your feelings, you're worried about hurting my feelings. If you're always pandering to whomever the boss is and not giving him or her your honest opinion, nothing good really becomes of that, and that's because you don't trust each other. So if trust is lacking, you're really going to be tentative when it comes to saying exactly what's on your mind. And believe me, with the Rays, I want our guys to tell me exactly what is on their mind. I don't want them to hold back the first year or second year t-shirts. Tell me what you think, not what you've heard. And on the front, it had the no regurgitation sign. So many times you get employees or people, and I'm talking about players, coaches sometimes, that just tell me things that they've already heard, and there's no original thought. I'm looking for original thought all the time. I wear this t-shirt here specifically today, where that imagination is more important than knowledge. I've always been that guy. I've always been the guy that has dreamed a lot of the idea kind of stuff. And from that, obviously spawns a lot of good thoughts, ideas, and you could continue to move forward. But that's how this breaks down. Build relationships. Then you trust each other. And then after that, now you get out of these, I mean, some like really good, healthy discussions or arguments in your room. And I'm telling you what, if you have these little discussions in the room and nobody's getting loud, it's not really that good. It's not that good. I want people, Bob Clear, you have no idea who this guy was, but being Bob Louise, he was an older man and he was my mentor with the Angels. But there would be some healthy, strong arguments that expletive deleted were a big part of it every morning during instructional leagues. And that's how I learned. I learned that because Bob wasn't afraid of hurting my feelings. He was, and I wasn't afraid of hurting his. And quite frankly, you can't hurt my feelings by telling me what you think. And for that group out there that gets your feelings hurt too easily, that a lot of time that's dealing with the victim's complex. You always think that somebody's after you, or woe is me and the world's against me. I really have a hard time with that also while I'm on the subject. I'm really not into the victims complex people. I think as employees or as team members, you got to be a superstar to really get away with it. So all of that, all this stuff is interrelated. Yeah, superstars get away with a lot of crap, man. You know, and you put up with it. You put up with it, but you still have your conversations with them. You still have the conversations with them. It's not like they get away with everything. You let them know that they're getting away with something. You just don't let them think that you don't know that they're getting away with something. And especially in our job with, you know, people making the money that they do, to not call BS on them once in a while, then you're not doing anybody any good. So I just went over a couple things. That's number one, relationships, trust. Equals constructive criticism and ideas. So that's the number one thing I wanted to get done in 2006 when I got to the Rays. And these are my thoughts. Okay, why do the Rays work so well? I had this question. I did the MLB network thing yesterday about 4:30 with Kenny Rosenthal and some other dudes in the office up there, their studio up in New Jersey, I think it is. This is another thought that came to me. You know, you talk about, you know, Escobar coming here, having had, you know, somewhat of a bad track record, which really, to me, is I don't listen to that stuff because I got to form my own opinions. I've had other guys like Fernando Rodney, not necessarily a bad guy, but people that maybe weren't doing as well as some folks thought that they could or should. This is the thought that came to me. This is what we do, and I only think you could do this and really. Within an accountable group of people, real pros, people that really care. You can only do this within that group. You give them as much freedom as you possibly can, or all the freedom that they need or want. Because the more freedom I give you or give my players, I believe the greater respect and discipline we're going to get in return. I'm going to get in return. Now, you can't do that with a bunch of fifth graders, obviously. You can't do that with a bunch of non-accountable people. You can't do that. But I'm here to believe and want to believe that this group sitting in front of me is highly accountable. And under those circumstances, me as the manager with you, I would want to give you as much freedom as possible because I know when you show up that day, it's all of you. There's nothing contrived. You're not trying to please me. And if you show up and you're absolutely free and clear, you're going to perform at your highest level. There's no doubt in my mind. There is no doubt in my mind. I'm describing me right now. If you want to get the best out of me, that's how you should deal or treat with me. So that came to my brain a couple years ago. Well, what is going on here? Just like I had that epiphany years ago with because of Gene, this is the thought I had a couple years ago. This is I think, the crux of our culture within the Rays. I know it can't work everywhere. I understand that. But again, I think when all the components are in place, and I think the number one word would be accountability, I really believe that it can. And that's when you really have a successful, fun place to work, when everybody feels the freedom to be themselves. I'm a big believer in that. I had my meeting yesterday with the boys. I'm here to tell you, and I know you can't do this everywhere, I just don't have any rules. I don't believe in it. I got the sign on the wall, integrity has no need of rules. I think that was Albert Camus that said that years ago. Integrity has no need of rules. So what I tell my players all the time, you know what's right and you know what's wrong. I don't care who you are, where you come from, how difficult it was or how easy it was. You know what's right and you know what's wrong. Everybody in this audience does. Choose right. That's what I ask my players to do, is choose right. I'm not going to sit here and lord over you. I don't have time to do that. I got my job to do. You got your job to do. Choose what's right. And, of course, if they choose what's wrong too often enough, they're not going to be raised. Whereas, I'm sure that if you choose wrong enough, you're not going to be among this group either. So it's pretty simple. I as a human being, and, you know, you read about what's going on in the Ukraine and Crimea and all the places and all the stuff. I'm a big reader. I mean, who would ever want their personal freedoms taken away from them? Why would you ever? And so I'm really adamantly opposed to anything like that. I'm not here to tell you how to act. Not at all. I'm here to manage you. So I'm not. I really want to give my players that kind of freedom, and I know we get the best performance out of them because of that. That's number two. Number three, the other epiphany I had in 1994, 95, Marcel Lachman was the manager of the Anaheim Angels. I think they were the California Angels at that time. Like Marcel, man, he would wear losses heavily, real heavily. Marcel would really wear it. And I'd sit with him in the office like 1 or 2 in the morning. And, okay, I'm sitting there, and again, what am I seeing here? Just like I said with Gene a couple years ago, what was I seeing when he said you've created a good atmosphere? Okay, people are saying you got this thing going on here in Tampa Bay. Okay, what were we doing here? So I had to try to define that. So I'm sitting with Marcel, and I'm trying to figure out, what is this Major League Baseball player all about? I mean, I never played in the big leagues. I was a minor league grunt. I played 3.5 years in the minor leagues, 3 with the Angels, 1/2 year with 2 independent teams in the California League. Really a lackluster career. Very unimpressive, I promise you. It cannot be more unimpressive. Although I thought I was a lot better. I thought they made some mistakes in regards to evaluation. But I could not have been more unimpressive than I was as a player. So I'm sitting there with Marcel, and I'm thinking, what is going on here? What is going on in my first, go around? I know it's 60 feet, 6 inches. I know it's 90 feet. I know the walls are pretty much the same. But I can tell you right now, it's an entirely different game. It's entirely different when you show up, because most of the time your body shows up but your brain does not. There's so much more going on. Cameras in your face, guys with notebooks, talk radio, all this crazy stuff. And I'll talk about that in a minute, too. But all this stuff's going on. So what's going on here? A, this is what I determined. Number one, the 5 levels of a professional Major League Baseball player, and I think it applies to all professions. Stage 1, I'm happy to be here. I guess I was that guy. I was just off the plane from Vancouver to Anaheim. I got called up, lost my brand new bomber jacket at the Hertz rental counter. I was so excited. It really upset me. So I was just happy to be there. I was happy to be there. Every player that shows up, I'm happy to be here. Okay, then you go to stage 2, which is really dangerous. Stage 2 of any profession is very dangerous for you and for the team. It's the point where you try to survive. Survival. God, I like this. I want to stay here. I'll do anything to stay here. But you never think about winning. You never think about really an original thought. You're just trying to not screw up. When you're trying to not screw up, you're really not that influential of a member of a team. But everybody goes through it. So you got to get out of that survival stage very quickly. And here's the important stage, stage 3. I can do this. I belong here. Once you arrive at stage 3, I can do this, I belong here, you breathe differently, you act differently, you see the world differently, and now you can contribute to the team once you think you know you belong here. And until you arrive at that point, I'm here to tell you, you really can't, because I went through it. I was a very good minor league coach, but I could not contribute to that team the first year I was there on the big league level. I just didn't get it. And I was still in that I'm happy to be here stage. Survival stage, what the heck's going on here stage. So I really couldn't contribute till I got to stage 3. I belong here, I can do this stage. And then I can make an impact with that group. Stage 4 is natural, and I don't slight anybody for this. I want to make as much money as I possibly can. And in Major League Baseball, I don't blame them. Why would you? You have a short shelf life. You're not going to do this forever. There's a lot of dough to be had out there. So I want to make as much dough as I possibly can. Absolutely. And we're all looking for the stage 5 player. All I want to do is win. So within the group out here and with my group, the guys or the ladies that all they want to do is win, that's the group that really contribute to make you great. And that's why the Rays could win 90 games 4 seasons in a row, or 5 out of the last 6, whatever it is. That's why the Rays can actually, believe this or not, since 2008 to present time, we have the second most wins in all of Major League Baseball behind the Yankees. How about that? That's because you have guys that are in a stage 5 moment, man. These guys, all they want to do is win. It's not about themselves. And when you get that group of people together, some really wonderful things can happen. Really extraordinary things can happen. And we got a bunch of those guys. So that was a thought that I had with Marcel Lachman. I think it was 1994, 95, in the bowels of Anaheim Stadium. 1 o'clock in the morning, before I drove home to Uncle Rick's house. I used to stay with my uncle out there. That was my thought there. Okay, this let's go into stage, my fourth point for today. This is something I've been talking to the boys about the last couple days. Am I okay with time? Sure? Okay. Do simple better. Everybody wants convoluted reasons or answers to questions. I don't. I want simple answers. I want simple thoughts given to my players. I want them to simply get ready for the game. As an example, all this stuff that's going on recently with instant replay and the collision at the plate. Okay, of course I knew about that all winter. Of course I heard about it all winter. Of course I got all the memos. Of course. But I did not know what I thought. So I kept thinking about it, because before I wanted to talk to the players, I wanted to make sure I was able to reduce it in its most simple forms to not confuse them. So I waited, and I waited. So then spring training, I started out with the play at the plate, and I gave them my take on that. and I felt good about my explanation. And then the instant replay, same thing. I waited and waited and waited, and then I gave my take on that and had them understand that, listen, this is a fluid situation. It's going to change. Be patient with this, just like you saw the last couple games. So the point there is that I did not want to present this convoluted, unknowing explanation just because I thought I had to. I think sometimes when you get in a position of leadership or you're in charge, whatever you want to call it, you always want to make sure that people know that you know what you're talking about. And a lot of times I will quite frankly tell them, I don't know. And if I think that's the best way to do it. If you don't know, say, I don't know. But when you start making stuff up, I mean, that's like talking to your teenage kid, isn't it? I mean, when you ask, you know, what's going on, and they come up with this convoluted response, and, you know, it's all fabricated. And when you get grown-ups doing it, it's really uncomfortable. And grown-ups do it, you know, so don't do that. Just say, I don't know. So, I mean, my way I deal with this is I say, I don't know, or I wait till I feel better about what I do know, and then I present it. And then at that point, be wide open. I think a real good quality of, of all leaders is listening skills. I've been asked, what's the most important thing you do as a major league coach when I did that for many years? And I thought about it, and I said, I listen. I can't be a helpful coach whatsoever if I don't listen to the player's problem. And most of the time, and I'm here to tell you, like even with you guys out there, if we work together and you had a particular problem and I happen to be in charge at that moment, the most important thing I have to do is listen, because if I do, I promise you'll probably answer your own question, your own problem. You'll develop your own solutions if I listen long enough and not interfere with the conversation. Don't you? I know I don't like it. You probably don't either. That guy or that lady that, as you're talking and presenting what's going on, they want to walk all over your conversation and present the solutions before you've had a chance to really finish your sentence. That is a really annoying quality. And I, you know, when I do that, I really call myself on that. I'll apologize to whomever I'm talking with. Say, hey, I shouldn't have done that. And then I give them the example I'm talking about right now. That's all interrelated in the stuff that I'm talking about. Do simple better. You saw this probably in the paper. You probably heard it. This came from Kenny Revisa, our sports psychologist who happens to be in town tonight. Kenny and I have been working together since the middle 80s. Kenny's a professor at Cal State Fullerton, and he's done a lot of work with baseball, collegiate, professional. He's done Olympics. He had some Olympic ice skaters this year. He's been with rugby teams in New Zealand. He does clinics in Europe. Kenny's really good. Kenny brought this to my attention this year. I absolutely love this. Do not permit the pressure to exceed the pleasure. Woof. I love that. I mean, especially dealing with our guys right now, what's going on, you know, all the expectations with the Rays this year, we're supposed to win the World Series. Listen, I love expectations. Throw them at us. Throw them, heap them on as much as you want. But it's our responsibility, our job, to not permit that to exceed how much pleasure we get out of the moment when we play baseball. It's a game. It is a game. And I'll comment briefly right now on, like, talk radio and media, newspapers, television, etc. I think it's great. I love that stuff. And I love the scrum every day with the writers. I'm looking to learn something. The stuff you see or read on TV, that's all commentary. The talk radio, that's purely entertainment. Any organization, and maybe it might be different from a political perspective, any organization professionally in a sport that relies on those kind of thoughts and have that impact your organization, you deserve what you get. You deserve what you get. Because at the end of the day, it's about what Stu thinks, Matt, Andrew thinks, everybody in the front office coming down to the field, what I think, what our players think, RV standing over here, Rick Vaughn, what he thinks, the guys. That's what matters. What's happening in that building is what matters. So I really try to encourage our guys to stay focused, stay in the present tense, stay in the present moment. And believe me, that matters, and it works. Anxiety lives in the future. When you stay in the present tense, it's much easier to take that breath, and you really want the breath to be the anchor. You always want the breath to be your anchor all the time. And listen, man, before I walked out on stage, truly, a little bit nervous, absolutely. You got to go through the breathing exercises. Let the breath be your anchor, always. And I always am. I'm always nervous. I'm always a little bit on edge. But as you get into it, it gets a little bit better. But to always remain in your comfort zone is really a boring place to live, man. To stay in that box is a really, I mean, who wants to live in a box anyway? You know, I mean, you talk about outside the box. Why would you want to spend all your time in a box? It's such a boring thought. The more you get outside that box, I promise you, a more fulfilling life, and you're going to feel a lot better about yourself. And just take that step. Just take that step, put it out there, get outside that really comfortable area, and you're going to find out you're going to really reach all your abilities and all your goals. You can't by staying in that box. You cannot. It's scary, but scary is good. I'm telling you, scary is good. And if you feel a little bit scared, if it's a little bit uncomfortable, probably something good is on the horizon. Something good is right there for you to have if you're a little scared. If you're never scared, man, you're never walking out, you're never poking your head out of the sand, yeah, it's comfortable, but it's not nearly as much fun. I mean that. Okay, a couple more points, and then if you have any questions. Reading that book right now, you see what I'm talking about, eating last? Talk about eating last, the race to eat last this year, meaning the last game of the season, win that, and that would be the last game of the World Series. Leaders eat last. When it comes to crisis situations, going back to 06 and 07, I didn't realize this at the time, but organizations or cities or whatever are not managed out of crisis. They're led out of crisis. And again, it speaks to what I was just talking about, you know, the chances that you take, the uncomfortable moments that you may have to experience, the tough decisions you have to make. It's about, I've read this too, go out on a limb because that's where the fruit is. You got to go out on a limb sometimes. Those comfortable moments near the base, again, I'm not really interested in that whatsoever. There's not a lot of fun in that point. You got to get out there willing to take the risks. And again, I mean, you know, you have to weigh everything. And I've never run a city. I don't know what it feels like to be a mayor. I've never been involved in government. So I guess that I might temper what I'd say based on if I were in that situation compared to what I do. But nevertheless, I would hope that I wouldn't stray too far from what I'm saying right now. Because I think you can understand. I firmly believe what I'm telling you folks right now. And it's been thought out for many years. I'm a thinker, and I do read a lot, but I do listen. And I've gotten all this to this point, what I'm saying to you now, from years of doing these different things. And like I said, it began in the middle 80s from one thought from Gene Mock. So understand that situations that are bad, you're normally led out of that bad situation as opposed to being managed out of that situation. And I mentioned the other stuff. Okay, last point, and then whatever you guys want to talk about. I've already talked about, you know, you want to have a little fun. I mean, I wear this T-shirt specifically. You know, I got my Van socks on in case anybody wanted to check those out. My Van sneakers. I don't have a dress code. I think you read that or heard that if you think you're hot, wear it. I say with baseball, again, I understand like in parochial school, I think new uniforms are great. You know, uniforms in a work situation, great, because, you know, it saves you money. It looks, you know, uniform regarding to the task at hand, et cetera. But baseball players, we get on a chartered airplane. Okay, so we go from the clubhouse at Tropicana Field to a bus parked right outside, up the freeway, to through the gate, to the tarmac, to the security right outside of the plane, to the stairs to the plane. And from there, back down in reverse the situation to the hotel. And these guys are like getting dressed to the nines. I mean, like I told them yesterday, like it's like the catcher is dressing well for the shortstop or, you know, whatever. It's like, who cares? I mean, who cares about these $2,000 suits? And then furthermore, when the young player gets on that doesn't have any money, and the players would poke fun at these young guys getting on, it used to bothered me a lot. So I don't want to gain your respect and discipline by forcing you to dress in a manner that suits my mores and how I feel about with dress. Years ago, we used to have to wear collared shirts, you know, polyester collared shirts, and like we couldn't wear jeans on like dirty buses to go from Quad Cities to Cedar Rapids, Iowa. I could never understand that. That didn't make any sense to me. Listen, I grew up in the late 60s and early 70s, so you understand where I'm coming from. So, I mean, I have not forgotten any of that. Not at all. I have not forgotten any of that. I get disappointed sometimes when I read about how people view the world now today that are in charge, that grew up right alongside of me, and they've forgotten exactly where they came from or why they think the way that they think. And that bothers me a little bit, but I have not. I have not forgotten where I come from, and I have not forgotten what I thought at that particular moment. And so when it comes down to things like this, to me, let's focus on what really is important. And that for me would be regarding the team, the stuff I had talked about, you know, the discipline and the respect that we get. I have running hard to first base for the position players. I want my pitchers to work on their defense. I want some tangible stuff that's going to make a difference in how they play, not how they dress. And, you know, furthermore, all these guys that made all these rules up regarding how you're supposed to dress were the worst dressers in the world. Why would I ever listen to these guys regarding how to dress? And they still are. All these people that tell you how to dress, they're bad dressers. Don't listen to them. It's true. Don't listen to them. They're bad. So I don't get any of my stuff from that. So the dress, get outside of your comfort zone. Even food, try new stuff, man. It's also okay, your kids, you never get them to try new foods. Try new stuff all the time. Theme trips. Okay, theme trips this year. I'm going to tell you what's going to happen. I talked to the boys yesterday. We're going Woodstock to Seattle in the middle of May. So I want Seattle. You know, they got these new laws out there. I just want to honor what they're doing. So we're going to go out there in Woodstock. So when you get off the plane, because I know it's on the verge of happening here very shortly. So again, we're just playing along. And so we're going to do that. And also I want a tuxedo trip, just the opposite of what you normally dress. So we're going to go tuxedos on one of our trips also. And I'm finding some really good stuff on eBay. It smells a little bit when it arrives, but then you just take it down here, and then it's okay. Last point, trying new things. Here's stuff that I do on a daily basis that really helps me a lot. The first thing I do when I wake up in the morning is I go through about 20 minutes of meditation. I learned this by listening to Wayne Dyer, is one of my favorites. Wayne Dyer's books and all his teachings, he's one of my favorites. So there's a little gig on meditation with him I started several years ago. And for 20 minutes in the morning, you could call it praying, you could call it meditation, you could call it both. But I'm here to tell you, and I read something recently, Rick just sent me this article from Harvard. It's got something to do with the gray matter in your brain. That group that meditates really has something to do with the thickness in the gray matter of your brain, that it can eventually help prevent degenerative disease in your brain as you get older. But I'm here to tell you, when you meditate in the morning and focus on particular items, it's really weird how it manifests itself during the day. Like today, for instance, coming here, one of the things I really wanted to focus on was being calm. That was one of my thoughts to myself this morning, to be brave, to be courageous. Those are the thoughts I have in the morning. Thinking about the game and talking to the players, whatever I want to manifest that day, I'm not talking about wins. I'm always about the process. That's what I meditate on in the morning. And you'll be surprised how it really plays out during the day. I don't know why. I have no idea why, but it does. I'm just telling you my experience. So I really believe in that. I'm not huge on yoga, but it's stretching. I think that's something that's really good for the mind and body. And again, listen, being a major league manager now, I just turned 60. The guys that don't do stuff like this, I don't know how they do their job. I mean, because you talk about a day, like yesterday I had my Godfather Day. Our Godfather Days, and like, remember when Michael Corleone took care of like Mo Green and Carlo? And there was the other guy out in the woods. Like, he knocked off three guys in one day. It was really a bad day. The baby was being baptized. That's a Godfather Day, when you take care of all your tough stuff in one day and don't let it fester. So yesterday was kind of my Godfather Day. And if you don't do all this stuff in the morning and get ready for that during the course of the day, I don't know how you do it. I couldn't do it. And following that is sleeping and eating well. I've really changed my diet over the last couple of years. We have a dietitian, nutritionist, and I'm here to tell you, man, it really helps. I mean, there's nothing better than sleeping well. And if you get a good, and I like eight. I'm a big eight guy. If I could at least get seven, I'm good, but I need eight. I mean, because what I do now is I got to think and I got to talk. So if I can't get my proper rest, I just don't function as well during the course of the day. So I'm a really big believer in that also when it comes to your job performance. I mean, I haven't cut out drinking entirely, but I know I like wine. So I really pick my spots, and now maybe two glasses max. You know, one glass is nice. And actually, the doctors say it's good for your heart. So it's the doctors give you permission. But even the beer consumption's gone way back. But I know the next day when you wake up and you got to think on your feet, man, I'm telling you, it makes all the difference in the world that you've taken care of yourself the night before. So with all this stuff, the theme trips, the fun, I want my guys to have fun every day. I want it to be loose but yet professional. And again, because of the freedom I give them, it comes back to respect and discipline in return. And I know they're all interrelated. And again, I don't know how it functions here. I don't know what it'd be like to be working with all you on a daily basis, but I'd like to believe I would try a lot of these things within a larger situation or group like this. And I'd be curious to see how it would play out. Because, again, I would give, it's all about the trust. The trust is going to you. You got my trust. Here it is. Boom. You got it. And then I got to earn yours back. But you got mine. I'm giving it to you freely. And that's how I kind of, it's not kind of, it's how I like to do things. And I think in the beginning it's difficult because there's a lot of people that don't, yeah, they're not buying into this right now. And there's that group that you have to kind of surgically remove, and that's going to happen too. And then eventually get to that nice team where everybody's working off the same sheet of music and great things happen after that. And I pretty much want to believe that's what's going on with the Rays today. So without any more, that's like a little capsule of what we do and how we've done it over the last several years. I hope that helps a little bit regarding what you guys were looking for. If you have a couple minutes, I'd be happy to answer any questions, or do you want to just not whatever you guys want? Anybody have any specific questions? I'm happy to do that a couple more minutes, or if you're good, we could wrap it. There's that guy that I heard on talk radio this morning. There he is. You see, sometimes the other pitcher's good too. Their guy was really good last night, and we knew that. He had come off Tommy John surgery a couple years ago, and his ball was just like jumping on our hitters at the end, and we weren't getting good swings all night. Alex took a while to get going, and then he settled in okay. But that's the beauty of 162 games. You're not going to win them all. And in order for us to get to the promised land, you got to win about 95 to win it this year. So how many losses is that? Like 62 plus 5. Like 67 losses, something like that, permits you to win it all. So you're not going to win them all. And the big thing is, and I'll just talk about this for briefly, we lost last night. I like our guys to lose hard for 30 minutes and then drop it. Because if you carry that bad moment into the next day at the office, man, nothing good could come of that. So I like to win hard for 30 minutes, and we celebrate. We have a great post-game celebration. Win hard for 30, lose hard for 30, and move on. That's what I got.
Council member over there.
One yes.
Council member.
Good, sir. How you doing? Whoa. Yeah, I mean, that's the 18-inning game against the Baltimore that we won on the soft hit to right field by David DeJesus. That's a pretty big moment for us. You know, when you get into those games, I mean, I can't emphasize enough how important it is to not get caught up in the outcome. As a manager, I'm talking about a manager, even as a player, but you got to keep playing what's happening right now. Manager, I got to look into the future a little bit regarding pitching, pinch hitting, pinch running. I got Davey Martinez telling me with all that stuff. But when you're a game like that, man, it is excruciating mentally. And you just got to stay with it the whole time. But you got to play that moment by moment, pitch by pitch. And but by the same token, you got to anticipate a positive result. That's the one thing you got to do. That's the one outcome-driven point that I'll permit myself. I got to permit myself to think of a positive result and not a negative result. If you're into that negative thing, that will absolutely wear you out. So it was a big moment in our season last year, but I truly mean when you get to that level of a game, one moment at a time.
That's right.
Good.
Thank you
very much.
Joe Maddon.
A new day in St. Petersburg, and city team, we have a new vision. Mike, can you pull up our vision chart quickly, if you can? That vision, again, it's a goal. Just as Mr. Maddon told us, we can reach any goal one step at a time. Every day, our individual actions will aggregate and get us to our vision. St. Petersburg will be a city of opportunity where the sun shines on everyone who comes here to live, work, and play. We will be a creative, innovative, and competitive community that honors our past while pursuing our future. It starts and it ends with the individual actions of everyone who is here in this room and everyone else who works as a part of the city team, and our city will move forward together. You know, this is pretty historic to come together as a city team all in one room, but the mayor and I talked about it. And we thought it was that important that you hear this vision and understand the expectation and understand the role that you will play in it, not from your leader, but direct from the mayor's mouth, directly from my mouth, and understand how you can make a difference. It's simple. Just as Joe Maddon said, we have four strategic pathways: stewardship and fiscal responsibility, innovation, impactful service, and community engagement. They arise from our values. The details are where you come in. The details happen in the department. The details are our budget, our allocation of resources, our allocation of time, talent, and skill. And every year, with the plans that you create, we will matriculate up those pathways toward that vision, which is an awesome destination. Mayor?
Thank you, Deputy Mayor. Before I make any other comments, I do want to welcome Councilmember Newton. I saw him out in the audience. He asked a question. I want to make sure I recognized him today. He's an important part of this team. And I don't know about all of you, but it doesn't surprise me after hearing Coach Maddon speak why this team has been as successful as it's been. So let's give him one more hand. There were a couple other points that he raised that I want to mention real quickly, and then we're going to hear from our own coach, Coach Dudley, the chair of council. But one of the things that he said that I think is really important is about being creative and innovative. And we know that each one of you that's sitting in this audience and every other employee who wasn't able to be here today are smart people. You wouldn't be working for the city if you weren't. You're creative, you're innovative, and we want to hear your ideas. So we want you to feel comfortable. If you've got a good idea, make sure that you let us know about it. And if we implement it, we want to recognize you for it, because you all have to have a part in what happens in this city. Your idea is just as important as mine is, so I want each of you to know that. The second thing that he mentioned that I think is really important, and that's to have fun. Now, we all come to work every day, and this is, working for a city is stressful at times. There's a lot of scrutiny. The public is looking at everything that we do every day. But if we're not having fun, if we're not enjoying the job, it's not worth it. One of my staffers who I was thrilled to get back, I won't mention his name because I always call him out. I won't call him out this time. But when I talked to him about coming back to work for the city, one of our administrators, and I said, would you come back? He said, only if we're innovative and if we have fun. And I guaranteed him that we were going to have fun doing this job. So I want all of you to enjoy your job. Have fun at what you do. And then the third piece I want to ask you all to do, and this is important, is while I want you to give 110% to this city, I want you to make sure that you take care of your family at home. Because if you're not taking care of your family, you can't come to work and do your job. So it's really important that you take care of what's going on at home before you come to work, and then come to work, have a good time, and give us 110%, and watch the sun truly shine on this great city. So now I'd like to introduce our own coach, the chair of City Council, Coach Dudley.
Well, I tell you, that's a pretty tough act to follow. I think Mr. Maddon has a great future in politics. What do you think? It's great. You know, I coming here today, and we're sitting down there, and something came to my mind, a couple of issues. My mind works weird sometimes, but I'm standing here, and I'm looking at all this going on, and I feel like I should be in an Apple announcement, you know, out in California where they have all the... I feel like we're going to introduce a new operating system for Apple computers.
But it's a new vision, Coach. It's a vision.
It's visionary, certainly. But it's really good to see all of you, and I know a lot of you. I can't even believe you're up on the second floor up there. But I want to say that you know, this is going to be a nice, great journey, and we're all going to be part of it. And I want to thank all of you for making our city the great city it is. Give yourselves a hand. You know, last night I was at the ball game, and there was a gentleman behind me from Canada, and of course he was cheering for the other team. But anyway, I almost had him convinced. But anyway, you know, he was saying about. I said, "Well, how do you like your stay in St. Petersburg?" and he says, well, we love St. Petersburg. This is the best city. We make it a point to come here every year. And the guy spends 3 months here. So that, I'm thinking, well, he spent 3 months, he's staying here, he's spending money, and that's the reason he's coming here is why. Because it is a beautiful city, great city, and it's all because of you. And I just can't say enough. Every year I go to the awards banquets for the employees, and I'm always amazed at the number of years that our employees put in. And why do they do that? Because it is a great place to work. And it's a great place. I think it's important that we all share the same vision. You've seen all this up on the screen today, and I think it's a vision that we all share. We all want the same thing. We want this to provide the best place to live for our citizens, where they live, they work, and they play. And it's important that we continue doing what you're doing. I don't know whether you can give 100% any more than you're giving, because you give that every day, day in and day out. And I really do appreciate it. And there's four things that I'm going to reiterate. We've done 100 times. Coach Maddon came out and really stole a lot of my stuff, so. But, you know, as one of the list of the five things he said about money, yeah, he's in that other bracket. I may want the more of it, you know, that ain't going to happen, you know, the old coach here. You know. I think the four things that we need to accomplish, and, you know, I equate this, you know, my professional career, I was a coach. And I did that for 38 years, and what I'm going to tell you, this is so much like coaching a team. We have a vision. We have a coach. Our coach happens to be our mayor and his team. They have come up with a vision. And you've seen the vision up on the board there. And in order to reach that, there are some things that we have to do. And I'm going to repeat what you've already heard, but I may put it in coach talk. Okay? Be fiscally responsible. That's one of our goals. It's, you know, it's money. It's our money. And we don't spend money that we don't have. The second thing is we need to be innovative. There are new ideas out there, believe it or not. You know, there's old guys like me that, you know, there are other ways to do things. And we need to be always aware of that. Next thing is we need to continue to be service-oriented. We are all public servants. I've been doing it all my life, and most of you have too. And the last thing is we need to be open and encourage dialogue. There are new ideas out there, and we need to listen. And those are things that are unique to our city because we are open. We talk about transparency. I'm not real big on that word, but it really is. It's really communication. And it's not a political ideologue. It is a common value approach to the way government works. It's not political. A pothole in the street that needs to be fixed is not a political issue. It's something that needs to be done, and it needs to be fixed because it affects our quality of life. So I want everybody to understand that we are a team, as we all know that I'm certainly in a different political persuasion, and that's okay, because this is local government. Somebody once said, keep it local, stupid, and we are. We're gonna keep it local. And I would ask that, you know, you guys do extraordinary things. And in closing, I would just like to say that I wish you would embrace the mayor's team, their vision, and by doing that, we are going to continue to make this the best place to live, a place that your children, your grandchildren, great-grandchildren will live here and never want to leave. This is a great place. So you are the most important part of the team. We can only give you what the vision is. You have to carry it out. And with that, I will say God bless all of you, and thank you for everything you do.
Woo, coach! Yes.
Thank you. Thank you, coach. Next, we'd like to welcome to the stage the city administrator, Dr. Gary Cornwell.
That's new. I want to first off thank all of you for being here. We knew this was kind of tough when the mayor originally came to me and he said, I want to put all the city employees in one place at once and we're going to talk to them all at once. And my first thought was, I'll try, but I don't think I can get them all in one room at the same time. I'm absolutely pleased and I'm very, very glad to see this many people here. We've actually filled up into the balconies and I think that's wonderful and I want to really thank you all for coming. As the mayor said before, this has never been done before. I've been here almost 34 years. I can't ever remember when we took people across all departments, all levels of the organization, field crews, office crews, and put them all in one room at the same time, especially in the middle of the day. So thank you for being here. And I don't want to forget it all. I want to also make sure that we thank all the folks that are still out there working that aren't here because we still had to keep the city running and something that the mayor and the deputy mayor very much wanted to be very sure of was that the citizens still had all the services they were entitled to, that we could all meet here, but there were still going to be those employees that were going to carry on the services. So a special thanks for the folks that aren't here. You will get your turn. I don't think this is going to be the last of these, and we'll try to make sure that we can rotate things around to make sure everybody gets a chance. Really, I'm not going to spend a lot of time. There was one thing I just wanted to say, that this is obviously very new. Not everybody just being here, but having an event like this. We've got city employees together. We've got visions. We've been compared now to Apple and Mr. Jobs. We've been shooting t-shirts out into the audience, and it's very, very different. And again, I go back to, I've been here a while. I'm working on my fourth mayor, on strong mayors. And this is very different. And I can tell you from working with all those mayors and being at City Hall that this may sound like a rah-rah thing, but this is really what the mayor and the deputy mayor and their administration is like. Things are very different at City Hall, I can assure you that. It is, maybe I don't want to use the word laid back a little bit, but the mayor said we're going to have fun, and one thing I can tell you is, we really do. We're serious, but we have fun. There is a focus, and every day I hear the words that you see up on the screen from the mayor and the deputy mayor, every time they're talking about the strategic pathways and the vision, and every time they make decisions and look at problems, they are focusing on those things. So really, this is not an act. This is no longer a campaign speech. That's done, at least for 4 years, right, Mayor? So really, I want you to understand that this is real. What they're asking, you're going to see more of this. I think it's going to work. It really is kind of a new focus and a new way to look at things. But please embrace it, understand it, take what the mayor says to heart. And as the deputy mayor is fond of saying, and we've all kind of learned, own it. So when you have your problem, you have the city, you've got your job, own it. Understand this is a new focus, it's a new day, but go out and have some fun. I think really you're going to find as we work our way through the next couple of years that this is really going to be something positive for you, for the citizens, and for all the visitors that we bring down here. So again, thank you very much for being here. I appreciate it, and we'll look forward to seeing you again.
Well, thank you all again for being here. Thank you for what you do every day for the citizens of this community, 250,000 strong, and nothing happens without you all. You know, one of the fun things that I will say that has happened in these almost 100 days since I've taken office is that when I'm out and around, people seem to always want to have a photo with me, or even my favorite is, Mayor, can I get a selfie with you? So I thought I'd have a little fun as we're ending up, and I've got my camera here, and I'm going to hold it out as far as my arm will reach, and I want to get a selfie with all of you. So if you all will stand for one last time, and then we'll let you go, I'm going to get a selfie here with everybody.
The mayor's going to tweet this.
And
so
we're
going to
tweet this.
Retweet it.
So here we go.
Woo! The sun shines here.
Thank you all so much.
Thank you guys so much.